By imposing a principle to pay for the roads justly as we consume of them, and therefore most efficiently, that is to pay most efficiently, we would impose a tax, for instance, on something that we consume that was related to and reflected how much of the roads we were consuming. So we would impose a fuel tax so that you paid for the roads by how much you drove the roads, more or less, with this perhaps having a certain range of disparity within it, which rightly penalized those who drove more consumptive vehicles and rewarded those who preserved a natural resource which is unrenewable, fuel, oil. So this might be the decided method of providing for paying for roads, their construction, and their maintenance. And this is how things would be done in mathematically perfected economy, owing to the principles which translate to the functions of government. So what does this mean? It means that in truth, that government never accumulates a debt. Never. It's rationally impossible for the government to accumulate debt. And all the while that it's providing us anything and everything that we truly need, we are paying exactly so much as what we are getting as we consume of it, as we do in our regular pursuits of life. So mathematically perfected economy makes it incumbent upon government to observe the same principles. And the result of this is that it's impossible for the government to accumulate any debt. Now, absolute consensual representation implies a further thing, and that is that no spending proposition, no provision of infrastructure or services, whatever, can transpire without a commitment of the people that, yes, we will be the obligors for this proposition. And those who choose to do so become the obligors. They're the only ones who can consume the benefits of it. They're the ones who pay for the benefits, what those benefits cost. And we have, in truth then, just government as well. What we have, of course, under the present obfuscation of the currency is a perpetually unjust government, the injustices of which inherently are escalated according to the multiplication of falsified indebtedness by interest. So this is a huge disparity. And of course, being that we've solved inflation, deflation, and maldisposition, being that we've solved systemic manipulation of the cost or value of money or property, and being as we've solved inherent, irreversible, and therefore terminal multiplication of falsified indebtedness by interest, all by eradicating interest and imposing an obligatory schedule of payment, retiring principal at the rate of consumption or depreciation of the related property. Being as we accomplish all that, a total perfection of economy by no more than eradicating exploitation, which is imposed in the form of interest, and by this obligatory schedule of payment. Two things, an eradication of interest and an obligatory schedule of payment. Perfect economy. Why? Because that simply returns it to its natural state of unexploited promissory obligations. And this is, of course, a dramatic further advantage over purportedly spending money into circulation, which I only introduced to my essay so many years ago to explain afterward what was wrong with funding government by spending money into circulation. But mathematically perfected economy then, recognizing that promissory obligations are the only vehicle to monetize our production because they comprise an obligation to pay and to retire principal from circulation, which makes them the only fitting vehicle because every unit has to be retired, paid and retired, according to consumption of the related property. So this has a tremendous advantage, not a disadvantage. People say, oh, money can't be debt. No, you didn't understand my explanation. You haven't understood it for 40 plus years. It's not debt that's the problem. It's not obligations, more specifically, which are the problem. It's multiplication of falsified debts by interest. Interest is the problem. It's the interest. It's the interest. It's the interest. If we prevented any money from being an obligation, what would this do? It would mean our newlywed couple, who can readily afford $83.33 a month to pay for a $100,000 home with a 100-year lifespan, would be denied that home, would be subject to exploitation, all the while that they were forced instead to save $100,000 from a circulation which couldn't even exist to an extent of representing that house which did not exist yet. And what is the offense of a promissory obligation against those people? They're only paying for the house as they consume of it. They pay the principal still. That's all they pay, is the principal. So while the purported debts, which instead are obligations to pay for property as we consume of it, as they impose no offense whatsoever against anyone under mathematically perfected economy, because we are still only paying the principal. At the same time, then, promissory obligations provide the tremendous advantage of sustaining further industrial production by allowing us to finance that production by further promissory obligations to pay, which are still to pay for that production as we consume of it. So there's no offense whatsoever from debt. The offense comes from interest. It comes from interest. It comes from interest. What interest damages us is many times with laundering the principal into the unwarranted possession of mere publishers of evidence of our promissory obligations offends us. That's a minor offense, the first crime of laundering all the principal in existence into the unwarranted possession of the mere publisher is a minor offense compared to multiplying falsified debts perpetually by interest, because the result of that is terminal failure. So it's the interest. This money as debt debacle is, I'm sorry, you've all gone way off to the side owing to some people who wanted to make some money and gain some fame from taking the right idea and immediately not even understanding it and pretending that, you know, an artist is a veritable researcher of these matters and has produced some cohesive, you know, presentation of important material, which instead of being important has actually led you terribly astray. So these are the reasons, nonetheless, that, you know, taxation under mathematically perfected economy has to conform with our principles of monetization. Monetization, of course, means taking our production and sustaining its consumption by tokenizing it in some way that we, the people, can pay for our own production with no more than equal measures of our own production as we consume of the related property. We pay for whatever we consume with an equal measure of our own production, which is what the very object of economy has always been, as opposed, of course, to this preposterous obfuscation, which can only multiply falsified indebtedness perpetually by interest until we suffer a terminal sum of federal debt, of private debt. It matters not, you know, in the end. We have to find our way to solution, or we have to suffer the consequences of our own iniquities. Thanks again for listening. I am Mike Montagne, and we are all related. Yeah, 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 yeah. What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us. Just a stranger on the bus trying to make his way home. Trying to make his way home. Back up to heaven.
Except for the Pope may be in